It is now my great pleasure to introduce the Right Honourable David Willetts, Minister of State for Universities and Science, who has championed the cause of innovation in health and life sciences across government and in this country and beyond. David.
Well, thank you very much indeed, and it was indeed a great event yesterday, the Global Health Forum. I think what you're seeing today is a kind of seminar version of an Olympic relay race, where we're trying to pass the baton between the different players that make up a very lively and vital life sciences sector. And what we particularly want to do today is to focus on our life sciences strategy that was launched by the Prime Minister in December of last year and really is a massive commitment by this coalition government to life sciences. And the different elements of the life sciences strategy are as follows. First, for me, especially with my ministerial responsibilities for science, I would obviously begin with the excellence of our science base. It's why we have protected the science budget in cash terms, but as well as the spending, there is the sheer freedom and vitality of our scientific community. When I go around our universities and research institutes, you meet so many young researchers who've come from abroad to work in Britain, because in Britain, the power of the baronial professor to determine everything they do is so much less than in some other countries. There is just a spirit of free inquiry, which matters as much as the funding. But we continue to try to back them with funding as well, and there are exciting new investments underway. I think of going to the Laboratory of Molecular Biology in Cambridge, probably the post-war world's most successful single research lab, 13 Nobel Prizes, now being rebuilt in Cambridge in a fantastic new building, where they've got the crucial insight that there are going to be no coffee machines on any floors. There's only going to be able to access coffee if you go to the canteen at the top of the building with the best views, which I'm sure is where the best ideas are going to emerge. We're also, of course, investing in the Crick Institute, scheduled to open in 2015, which we hope will be another of one of the world's great research centres. And around the country, outside the London, Oxford, Cambridge network, there are incredibly exciting university-based research activities going on in places like Manchester or Dundee. So we've got the science base. Then there's the skills base, secondly. And you've already heard from Lord Darzi about the high quality of training in the NHS, but we realise we need to ensure that university training is of the highest quality. We produce large numbers of STEM graduates. We're working with the Society of Biology. We're introducing an accreditation programme also to make sure they've got the wet skills, the lab skills, which business is looking for as well. And because of the importance of technicians and technical training for the life sciences industry, we've introduced a new one-stop technical apprenticeship service so that any business that wants to recruit or find apprentices will have a simple online way of doing so. Then thirdly, we've got to do a better job of translating the science into applications. When I talk to funders of science elsewhere, for example, the NIH in the US, it's clear the NIH goes closer, further downstream than conventionally the Medical Research Council has done in Britain. So we're tackling that problem by getting the Medical Research Council to work more closely than ever before with the Technology Strategy Board, which finances the applications, finances work that brings medical ideas closer to commercialization. And as evidence of how serious we are about that, we launched last December a new £180 million fund, our Biomedical Catalyst Fund, which comprises of £90 million of Medical Research Council funding and £90 million of TSB funding, for those two institutions to work together to take ideas closer to market. And I'm very pleased to be able to announce today the first commitments of funding from that scheme. The MRC has awarded £7.4 million of confidence in concept funding to 14 UK universities, and in addition, 18 SME-led projects have been awarded a total of £2.4 million by the Technology Strategy Board, and there will be, probably in October, announcements of funding for larger transactional projects alongside that. So we're absolutely committed to ensuring that we take the ideas from the lab as close as possible to commercialization. And that is why we've also, as part of our program of catapult centers, roughly based on German Fraunhofer Institutes, one of our catapult centers is in cell therapies, going to be based at Guy's Hospital in London, part of our wider commitment through the MRC and the TSB to regenerative medicine. So that's the science base, the skills base, the commitment to taking the science research closer to market. Then fourth, I would add the NHS's own excellent research infrastructure. And I pay tribute here to the commitment of my colleagues in the Department of Health, Andrew Lansley, who'll be joining us later on, Freddie Howe, who is with us already, Sally Davis, who is with us, who is the head of R&D in the NHS, who are absolutely committed to the NHS's own research effort to the tune of £1 billion a year, specifically through the National Institute of Health Research. And what I notice, talking to people from the life sciences industry, is how impressed they are by some, again, of the recent innovations we've introduced to make NHS R&D more accessible to the industry. I think, for the example of the Office for Clinical Research Infrastructure, NOCRI, which will connect industry to the best investigators, research facilities, and technologies. So if you're wanting to start up, investigate a particular area of research that interests you, a great place to start is by getting in touch with NOCRI. And of course, as well as that, we understand the importance of clinical trials and the data that can be made available through clinical trials, which I'll turn to again in a moment. So we've got the NHS itself, a powerful engine of research in our life sciences system. Fifth on my list would be our commitment as a coalition to working closely with business. It's a commitment to making Britain the best place in Europe to set up, to start, to run a business. We want to attract R&D investment and wider business investment into our country, which is why it's great to see so many people who've come here today from around the world. And we're trying to do that through improvements to the tax system, a commitment to steady reductions in the rate of corporation tax, particular improvements in the R&D tax credit regime, with the tax credit being available above the line in future. And of course, the patent box, a significant innovation in our tax regime. And as soon as George Osborne announced the patent box, we immediately saw a big announcement by GSK of a major £500 million investment in manufacturing in the UK. As the Prime Minister said yesterday, we don't buy this pessimistic argument that manufacturing is always going to head to Asia. We believe that high-tech, sophisticated manufacturing in pharmaceuticals and elsewhere can happen in Britain, and we are committed to ensuring that it does. And then sixth on my list would be the wider commitment to the National Health Service, which was celebrated in such an extraordinary fashion at the opening ceremony last week. And the scenes from the celebration of the National Health Service, I think, were quite exceptional. And they showed something, I think, very unusual about our nation's relationship to the NHS. I was discussing it with David Nicholson, who was pointing out to me, it's hard to imagine an American Olympic ceremony beginning with a celebration of Medicaid and Medicare. So there is something rather distinctive about our attitudes to the NHS. And this is relevant for the life sciences industry. Because although, of course, we go through these processes of whether people should opt in or opt out or whatever of clinical trials, that isn't really the issue. The fact is there is an enormous voluntary commitment amongst patients to putting back, through participating in research, something that they feel they have benefited from the NHS, which is why we have outside Manchester, a biobank with 500,000 tissue samples, medical records from volunteers carefully collected over the years between 2007 and 2012, a quite exceptional research resource. It's why we already have a higher proportion of patients with cancer or whatever participating in research and clinical trials than in almost any other advanced Western country. And we know we've got to make that even more accessible to you, which is another feature of our life sciences strategy. And we know we've got to work with you in ensuring that the medical data generated by those patients is easily available and accessible. And part of my agenda as science minister is to harness the power of IT and high-performance computing and Britain's fantastic record in software to areas of research like life sciences. This is the 100th anniversary of the birth of Alan Turing this year. We have got a great strength in informatics, in IT, in software, in algorithms, and through our continuing investment in bioinformatics, we're committed to trying to ensure that that raw patient data is also available for sophisticated analysis on a scale that's not available in any other country. And it's why I'm also delighted to be able to announce today that we are also committing £19 million to with other funders, to a UK e-health informatics research initiative. It'll be led by the Medical Research Council, and they've awarded £90 million to four e-health research centres based in London, Manchester, Dundee and Swansea. Put all that together, and I do think there is an unrivaled opportunity to harness the scientific base of Britain, the quality of our NHS, the entrepreneurship of the life sciences industry to tackle the global health challenges that were debated yesterday. So I'm grateful to you for joining us today, and it now gives me great pleasure to hand over to David Nicholson, the Chief Executive of the NHS, to describe the NHS's role in that crucial project. Thank you very much indeed.